having a tough time hearing you because the rains are pelting, but they definitely want people to stay off the roads as much
yes,
as possible.
We're headed back.
What are you seeing out on the road so far here?
Well, I've been here all my life.
A lot of power lines down and trees and a lot of snakes on the road.
I can't believe you guys are out here. You're about the only ones we've seen. I know we're not holding up any traffic.
I'm going to apologize. I can't hear a word you're saying right now, but you guys be safe and take care of yourselves. They definitely don't encourage the sightseeing out here, but at least they were able to give, hopefully, you guys some perspective of what's going on. Hey, Mike, Anna, take a look at this here. I'm just fighting this sea of weed here, trying to fight the storms here. This is just insane. It has been relentless up here in Seminole County, and it just keeps getting more and more intense. I'm assuming, again, Reynolds, that we are in the midst of one of those bands.
Some pretty incredible pictures. We thank Orlando affiliate WKMG-TV. You could see that reporter getting tossed around by the heavy winds and the rain, and the reporter stressing that it is not safe to go out there. You saw a couple of people in a car, some storm trackers, but Florida Governor Jeb Bush urging all Floridians to stay safe, to stay in shelters until they are told their neighborhoods are safe. We are following Hurricane Francis, downgraded to a Category 1 storm, still winds of 90 miles per hour. We're moving ever so slowly across the state, just about 7 miles per hour. Those pictures you see now. We want to put up numbers on our screen. The American Red Cross urging Americans who want to help. Donations definitely needed. You can call 1-800-HELP-NOW. If you are in the state of Florida and you need some help, call that response center number 1-866-GET-INFO. And those numbers and staffers are ready to help you. More of CNN's extensive live coverage of Hurricane Francis just ahead. Don't go away.
Hey, good boy. We'll be right back. Don't steal the car.
Hey, what did you do?
Unlock the door.
You get the keys.
Yellow Book, solving life's little problems. Yellow Book, not the other book. Call 1-800-YB-YELLOW.
Every morning, CNN's American Morning connects you directly to the news.
CNN is now reporting.
Breaking news.
What a moment of panic.
Trust American Morning, where real news makes the difference. CNN Monday, 7 Eastern.
Precision driving teaches about corporate and investment banking. The right combination of horsepower and agility can produce remarkable results. Wachovia Securities, corporate and investment banking. Talk to us.
What can an oil company do to gain your trust?
I want them to focus on making our environment cleaner, keeping to the EPA standards, being better than the EPA standards.
It's baseball season, imperfect. Here, bases and cameras are always loaded. RBI stands for Really Big Ice Cream. And the home team's record is spotless, as are their uniforms. Of course, life isn't always perfect, so there's Walgreens, open every day, many 24 hours, with everything needed to have a little fun. That's life. This is Walgreens.
If you were born between 19...
Floridians who evacuated are already anxious to come home and find out what damage is waiting for them. The director of Florida's Division of Emergency Management is urging patience. Joining us now from Tallahassee, Craig Fugate. Mr. Fugate, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
I guess first and foremost, is that your first concern, that Floridians might think the worst is behind them and start rushing to their homes?
Oh, absolutely, particularly people that traveled away from the areas. We got very dangerous conditions on these interstates as people try to head back in. So I realize that you're frustrated, you want to come home, but I just need to ask you, please give us time to get in these areas, make sure they're safe, and let this storm move on off our coast. And again, we have residents now in the Panhandle. Hurricane watches will be going up, and we may be evacuating the Panhandle later on this afternoon, early tomorrow.
And what are some of the biggest areas of concern for you? Flooding must be one of your top priorities right now.
Flooding, but this storm had a lot of wind. We've got a lot of reports, different places of some wind damage. Again, as we're just now getting out and starting to see what's happened, Melbourne and other areas are still being pounded by the storm. So it is by no means over that it has moved inland. We still have impacts now going through Polk County, heading towards the Hillsborough County, Tampa Bay region, going into the Gulf. So by no means is the storm over, and by no means is the damage stopped.
And what's the initial assessment of any casualties, injuries from Hurricane Frances? Anything you can tell us now?
No, we've gotten some scattered reports, but again, the way that we work this in Florida, medical examiners will be handling this process. That will be how we're going to determine if any fatalities are related to this storm. But obviously, we are very concerned about life safety. That's why search and rescue teams are now, as soon as they can get out going. We're not going to wait for blue skies to start this process. We just need to make sure the crews can be safe as they begin to operate as this storm moves out of these areas.
And what's the sense of the scope of power outages across the state right now?
Well, this is bigger than what I think we saw there in Charlie. And again, as we speak, power is still going out. I want people to understand, this storm makes landfall, it just doesn't end. It's still a very powerful storm crossing the state. Damage is still occurring, power outages are still occurring. More residents are losing power, and this will continue as this storm tracks across our coast.
We spoke with the president of the American Red Cross in the last hour, and she talked about one of the biggest concerns, people going to their homes and thinking they are in the clear, but they have to be careful of down power lines, standing water, other hazards such as those, don't they?
Absolutely. Our big fear is in Hurricane Charlie, more people died after the storm than died during the storm from accidents, power lines down, carbon monoxide poisoning, and a whole lot of preventable deaths and injuries. So again, we're asking people to be safe. As the storm's in your area, stay inside. Let the emergency crews get their jobs done. Let the utility crews secure those power lines. We do not want people to lose their lives because they came out and got into these areas too soon.
And Mr. Fugate, emotionally, what is this doing to the state of Florida and Floridians dealing with Hurricane Frances, such a slow-moving storm right now, just 3 weeks after Hurricane Charlie?
I think Governor Bush sums it at best. You know, we're getting battered, but the heart's strong, and we'll survive, we'll rebuild. But I can tell you it's very frustrating here in Tallahassee and for the people on the ground that we're having to wait for this storm to move through so we can get into the response mode. But again, Florida is a very strong, as Governor Bush says, a very resilient state. We're going to get through this. We're going to rebuild. We're going to recover. But it sure is frustrating, and we're just ready to get to work.
Craig Fugate, we thank you for joining us, and we will keep checking back in with you throughout the day. Craig Fugate, head of the Office of Florida's Division of Emergency Management from Tallahassee. Thanks again, sir. And now we want to take a look at what's going on in Melbourne, Florida. A short time ago, we saw an affiliate reporter who was getting pummeled by heavy winds and rain. We turn now to Bill Hemmer to get a look at what the situation is. Bill, what's it like there right now?
Kelly, listening here to guests talk about Melbourne getting hammered, that's still the case here. This is Sergeant Sean Reardon. He's with the police department here in Melbourne, public information officer. And we tried this a couple of hours ago. We lost the satellite signal. You've been out surveying the area. What have you found?
Yes, what we do is we have contingencies of officers out in our city right now going through our major roadways, trying to see what kind of damage we have. We're trying to do an organized effort to report that damage. We're finding a lot more power lines down than what we had when last time I was here.
Those power lines, hot or not?
You know, so I wouldn't doubt if some of them are hot, but it's hard to tell at this point.
You also say some homes have caved in, at least their roofs anyway. How many? How severe?
Right. We had a few homes last night during the nighttime hours that the roofs did cave in. We were able to get there and evacuate the people out of those homes. The winds were very high, but we still went out and we got them out.
Any injuries?
No injuries thus far.
Any injuries across the area that you can talk about?
No, there's a lot of people, I think what's happening now, that the people that stayed here, they're starting to worry about what's going on, and they're calling for medical assistance and things of that nature.
Well, despite, I don't mean to interrupt you, but despite the winds behind us, you paint a pretty optimistic picture about the expectations for this storm.
Right. Well, I feel, and we've been planning and preparing for this. We just went through this with Charlie recently, expecting stuff like this. We never got it then. But now that put us into a mode where we are prepared now. We're prepared all the way into the future right now on how we're going to handle things. We have resources waiting. Our officers are out there. They know what to do. And pretty much we're trying to make sure our message gets out to the residents who did the right thing by evacuating and watching your show now. that they know that we're doing everything we can to make sure their property is secure and that we get some sort of damage report. But right now, overall, the city weathered fairly well.
Sergeant, thank you for your time and thanks for coming back. We really appreciate the information. Good luck to you the rest of the day today. Kelly, in the meantime, though, last time we talked, we
was in West Palm Beach. Sean, what's the situation there like right now?
Well, we're picking up some more rain. A nasty squall came through within the past 15 minutes, clearly showing that Francis has not completely left this area. Wind still whipping somewhat. We're still getting rain as we have for the past 28 or so hours. If you look down, you can see what's starting to happen. This is a scene that's playing out throughout Palm Beach, West Palm Beach. Some of the roads filled up with water. There's still debris down in many areas. Also, just across the way, across the intercoastal waterway, of course, is Palm Beach. And that a barrier island that was hit extremely hard. Right now, officers are stopping anybody from trying to drive over there and check out damage. But we had a crew over there early this morning to take a look. We know that bulldozers were out trying to move palm trees and other trees that had fallen down in the middle of roads. Not a tremendous amount of structural damage that our crew was able to see in the short time they were there before the police asked them to leave. We do know there are a number of down power lines. Palm Beach County, about 1.3 million residents, a lion's share of them still without electricity at this hour and probably will be for some time to come. We know that the residents, Kelly, in this house and the one just next to it chose to ride the storm out. And right now, pretty good indication of some of the concerns that are lingering after the teeth of Francis have moved on. This royal palm tree is a precarious angle now. If you look down here, you can see these trees aren't known for their extensive roots. This one is ripping out of the ground. Folks next door came out and looked at this, and they fully expect this is going to come down, but they hope it goes down in a very slow fashion rather than falls down rapidly, causing any damage to the home. Also, you can just see how this area is strewn with all kinds of debris. There are street lights down as well, some cars that were left out, also feeling some of the damage from Francis last night. Authorities, Kelly, are asking people not to come out and begin assessing the damage, do anything like that at this hour. They're still concerned with all of the debris on the ground. The winds could kick up, turn this debris into a missile, for lack of a better word. So they're urging people to stay out, but we're seeing a pretty healthy amount of traffic up and down this way. Kelly, I want to finish with one more item before we throw it back to you. Yesterday on CNN, we showed you a yacht that had broken free of its moorings and drifted down, and the skipper was able to dock it at the Palm Beach Yacht Club overnight. Well, apparently, it broke free of its moorings. The captain just pulled up. It is now across the intercoastal waterway, apparently pinned against another yacht. And the captain told us that thing is not anchored. It is not tied down. It is simply wedged in there. Right now, the wind is blowing from the southwest.
Hurricane Francis continues right after this. Stay with us.
You have the most beautiful hands.
While other mortgage companies are still filling out the paperwork, Ditech.com is busy processing your loan. Right now, you can apply for a second mortgage with a no-closing cost option. It's a whole new way to get a mortgage. Ditech.com. Apply online or call 1-800-DITECH-1. Ditech.com, your mortgage solution delivered.
A little more to your left, and then straight ahead.
Just as I expected. The lines are getting alarmed. Incredible.
Whatever happens, hold your ground.
People don't always use common sense.
Now, initiate agitation phase.
Fortunately, there's a healthcare company that does. At United Healthcare, we offer tools to fight rising costs, a 24-hour nurse line, and preventive healthcare solutions. United Healthcare. It just makes sense.
Wow, you have beautiful hands.
Uh-huh.
More Americans trust CNN than any other news organization. Another reason why CNN is the most trusted name in news.
So, little Ronnie and I were gonna do guy stuff, watch the game.
But no, he wants to watch cartoons.
Time to watch one show while you record another.
I said, Ronnie, we gotta watch games.
Time to call and upgrade to digital cable with the DVR from Time Warner Cable. Watch what you want, whenever you want.
Now with the DVR, nobody misses a show or cartoons.
Call 612-522-1000 to order your DVR service today. Time Warner Cable. Now anything's possible.
Hungry child, I did not make this world for you. You didn't buy stock in my corporation. You didn't invest in my mutual fund. I made this world for the rich and the will be rich. Not for you, hungry child.
Stay with CNN this weekend for continuous live coverage of Hurricane Francis.
Updating the latest now on Hurricane Francis, the National Hurricane Center has issued a hurricane warning for the Gulf Coast of Florida. The warning covers the area from the mouth of the Suwannee River to Destin. A warning means hurricane conditions are expected within the next 24 hours. Hurricane warnings for the Bahamas have been discontinued. Francis still has maximum sustained winds of nearly 90 miles per hour and is moving west-northwest at 9 miles per hour. It is expected to hit the Gulf Coast sometime by early Monday morning. Florida's Governor Jeb Bush is warning residents to sit tight until officials say it is okay to go outside. At a briefing this morning, Governor Bush promised thousands of emergency responders will not wait for blue skies to move into action. He hopes to tour Florida's ravaged East Coast later today. And in South Florida, international airports in Miami and Fort Lauderdale are up and running again, but it will be a few hours before some airlines are back in business. Southwest Airlines doesn't expect to resume service until sometime tomorrow. One of the towns on the Florida coast hit hardest by Francis was Vero Beach. The city-owned utility says just about every one of its customers lost power in the storm. Vero Beach Mayor Thomas White joins us now by telephone with an update on how the town is handling the storm. Mr. Mayor, thanks for joining us.
Just to let you know, our power plant right now is underwater. Some of the water over by the west side of the river, Indian River Lagoon, is probably waist high, and we're having a lot of problems at the sewer and power plant. As soon as we can get the levels to go down, we'll be in there trying to get water, at least water and sewer, back online.
Is that your biggest concern right now, Mr. Mayor, the power plant and getting power to your customers and your residents?
Well,
in that
besides
area?
Power, we're more interested in getting them water and sanitary facilities so they'll be able to use their bathrooms. And
What's
we're trying to get those back in line.
What's the extent of the damage, if you've been out to look around, the extent of the damage in the town of Vero Beach?
We have extensive damage as far as trees, down limbs, power lines, power poles. We have some roofs that have come off some buildings. We've had a lot of flooding over on the east side towards the barrier island. We've had, in fact, we just had 9 elderly people at a manufacturer home park who decided to camp out at their community center. And they were almost waist deep of water, and the police were able to get in and to get them out and get them into a shelter. So we've been trying to keep everybody safe, and the storm is supposed to, the heavy winds should be gone hopefully by noon.
Any word of casualties in your town, in your area?
Not as of yet. We've had a couple small injuries and things like that, but everybody's so far has been very safe.
That is great news indeed. What's your sense? Are your residents in your area staying put and staying inside? We're seeing in other towns across the state, people are starting to get outside and look at the damage. What are you seeing in your area?
We're starting to see the same thing. Some of the people are coming out. We do still have we have not lifted our curfew yet, and we do have police officers out, and we are telling them to get back inside till we get the all clear.
Mr. Mayor, give us a sense of what the past 24 hours have been like as you watched and listened to this storm ravaging through Vero Beach and other areas.
This is probably one of the worst ones that's ever hit Vero Beach. Even David was bad, but nothing compared to Francis. Francis has done a lot of water damage. It's done a lot of wind damage. And we've never experienced a wide range of problems. Our generators are flooded out. That's the reason why we're even down in our water and sewer, because our generators went out.
And where are you joining us now from, Mr. Mayor? From your home or where?
Right now I'm heading to the command center. As soon as I hang up, but I did ride the storm out of my home last night.
And the advice to residents of Vero Beach right now, what's your advice to them?
Hopefully we'll be able to give an all clear in the next few hours. I would say later this evening. Governor Bush is supposed to arrive here around 6 o'clock. The National Guard is supposed to be coming in a little after noon.
And you're getting all the help you need so far?
Well, they've been offered. They're coming. They told us they're on their way, so we're waiting for them.
All right, we'll check in with you later to see. Thomas White, Mayor of Vero Beach, thanks for taking some time to join us by telephone this morning.
You're very welcome.
And now, just where is the storm? How strong is it? How slowly does it continue to move across the state of Florida? For answers, we turn to Rob Marciano at the CNN Weather Center. Rob, what's it looking like right now?
Kelly, it hasn't really diminished in strength over the past 4 hours. It's still a strong Category 1 storm with sustained winds at 90 miles an hour. Probably in part because, you know, much of the state of Florida is swamp and marsh, and you got Lake Okeechobee there, maybe helping this thing sustain itself. Anyway, it's engulfing the entire state. Cirrus run all the way up to South Carolina, as do the battering waves with this particular storm. As far as the winds are concerned, interestingly enough, the most intense winds, or at least gusts, have been fairly far away from the center. I mean, Port Canaveral, 124 mile an hour wind gusts. That's the first, the highest wind gust that we've seen, and that was easily 70 miles away from the center of this thing. And even Orlando at last hour, a 69 mile an hour wind gust, and that could easily increase because Orlando is in the path of what's going to be left of this hurricane, which doesn't seem to want to lose any strength. On top of that, you go east of the center of this thing, as always, you have the possibility for what we call spin up tornadoes. Typically, they're pretty small in intensity. However, it's a pretty wide box that we look for the threat to exist as we go right on through the afternoon as this thing continues its slow march across the state. All right, exactly where is it? It is 80 miles east-southeast of Tampa. It has winds of 90 miles an hour, gusting to over 100. It is a strong Category 1 storm. Its movement is west-northwesterly at 9 miles an hour. This painted in yellow are the tropical storm force wind field. In the red, getting smaller, thankfully, the hurricane force wind field, but still a hurricane as it moves across the state of Florida just to the south of Orlando. Watch how that wind field in the center, the red, begins to shrink just a little bit. It's going to take a while for it to get to the coastline. I mean, a movement just under 10 miles an hour and about 100 miles to go, you got about 10 hours before it hits the coastline north of Tampa. By then, it should be down to a tropical storm, but still a strong one at 60 miles an hour, and that would be at 8 o'clock tonight. As of the last forecast advisory, now the Hurricane Center brings this back up to hurricane strength as it heads towards the Apalachicola coast and the Panama City area early tomorrow morning with winds 75 miles an hour sustained, gusting higher than that. So we're looking at the potential for a second landfall of Hurricane Francis as it heads across the panhandle of Florida during the morning hours tomorrow, then eventually up and through Alabama and Mississippi, bringing with it a fair amount of rainfall to the southeast. What's going to bring it up there? Well, this cool front, which is finally going to help steer this thing. We've had not a whole lot going on across the northeast the past couple of days, and that's why Francis hit the brakes and didn't really have anywhere to go. It's been so frustrating for the Florida residents, along with forecasters as well, trying to get this particular thing out of here. Next item up for business is what was Tropical Storm Ivan. Now it's Hurricane Ivan. And this thing is actually forecast to become our fourth major hurricane of the season. Could get into the Caribbean. Extended forecasts bring it somewhere in here by the end of the week. If I could, I want to switch to PA 7 and show you some interesting shots now that the sun is up. And this is of Hurricane Francis back to Florida. Look at how big this thing is. This is a visible satellite picture. Pretty much we have to wait for the sun to come up because the sun is actually our light, our flashlight, or our flash on the camera. And then we look at the actual visible clouds, and then we'll bump this and give you a little three-dimensional look at this thing. From the Keys all the way up to the Carolinas, this storm is a monster, Kelly, and it just doesn't want to weaken. Wind's still at 90 miles an hour. And some of the squalls that are moving through Melbourne easily packing sustained winds of hurricane strength. And now it seems like some of that action is moving into Orlando. It's been the ongoing story. This thing refuses to give up, and it'll be a long day as we go through the afternoon. And then maybe the panhandle of Florida tomorrow early morning, Kelly, with a secondary landfall possible.
Exactly. And Rob, put this all in perspective for us. We are really just at the beginning, right, of hurricane season?
Yeah, well, we're getting towards, we're ramping up, I like to say. The middle of September is the peak. So typically September is the busiest month. August, I should mention, was a record-setting month when we had 8 named storms. So you're right in that we're not even halfway through, really. We'll get to that in a couple of weeks here. So it's not unusual to have more than one storm brewing in the Atlantic Basin at one time. We've just had a number of them hit the U.S. seaboard, especially Florida, and this one could be the next one, so we'll just have to watch that. First, we'll deal with Francis trying to get it out of Florida, but having a tough time doing so. Still sustained winds of 90 miles an hour. Still a strong Category 1 hurricane. Back to you.
Rob Marciano working 24/7 from the CNN Weather Center. We'll keep checking in with you, Rob. Okay. Thanks. And in the past hour, the earlier hour, we were on the phone with CNN's Carl Penhall, who was joining us from Freeport on Grand Bahama Island. Our connection went down. Carl's on the phone now. Carl, what's the situation there on the ground?
Well, obviously, as weather experts were telling us, when the storm did pass over Grand Bahama, then it was a hurricane Category 3. But those winds are now subsiding, and it's now become a tropical storm. That's brought a lot of rain with it, though, too, Kelly. And so the pounding that the island has had is now being lashed by rain at this stage. What the emergency services are trying to do right now is get feet out on the ground, get the patrol cars out, get the fire trucks out. And what they're doing is a preliminary damage assessment, checking out the buildings that have had roofs ripped off. They're checking out the power lines to see how long it may take to get power back to the island. A partial telephone service has been restored, but only very partial. There is still no cellular phone service. Now, the main thing in terms of fatalities and injuries, what the Bahamas police are reporting to us, are that there have been 2 deaths. One was on Friday in Nassau. The body was discovered yesterday, a drowning death here on the west side of Grand Bahama. And an 80-year-old man is still listed as missing. Early searches for him have still turned up nothing. He went missing when his home was completely flattened by the wind. Over the next few hours, though, the police are saying that they're going to mount 1 or 2 operations to bring people from some of the lower-lying areas to drier land, to shelters where they can dry off and wait for the tidal surges to subside. Those tidal surges 8 feet in places, flooded areas such as the airport and the north and west side of the island. The west side of the island is currently out of communication with the rest of the island. The road is blocked by debris, although we are told that the tidal surge has now subsided from there, Kelly.
And Carl, we were talking to you about this last hour. Our viewers are seeing some pictures with extensive flooding throughout the area, streets, avenues. You have any sense of how deep some of this flooding is in certain areas?
Some of that flooding, Kelly, was about 8 to 10 feet. We saw some of that particularly yesterday afternoon, because here, at least in the Grand Bahama, the back tail of Hurricane Francis was way more powerful, way more vicious than the leading edge. And then as the eye of the storm came in, obviously there was a calm here, but then that tail edge really lashed the island, and so that brought with it heavy rain, but particularly the tidal surge of around 10 feet. That forced some people to clamber up onto their roofs for refuge, those, of course, who still had roofs on their houses, and the fire trucks and emergency services were working hard there to pull people out and take them to other shelters. But some of that flooding, obviously before the hurricane hit, there was a wide-scale evacuation plan from oceanside areas, but the police and other emergency services were very surprised because some of that tidal surge came several miles inland, and that was where additional evacuations, emergency evacuations, had to be carried out. But as I say, here on Grand Bahama, 1 fatality we know of so far, 1 man still listed as missing, and then, of course, that other death on Nassau, Kelly.
Thanks, Carl. Carl Penhall with the latest from Freeport on Grand Bahama Island. We will keep checking in with him throughout this day. When we come back, more live coverage of Hurricane Francis and an update on the power outage situation. More than 1.5 million Floridians without power. We'll talk about efforts to get power to people throughout the state. That's next. CNN's live coverage of Hurricane Francis continues right after this. Don't go away.
CNN Sunday is brought to you by Fairfield Inn by Marriott, for travelers who know.
So these are the roads.
I think I'll have the special.
You don't have the special.
Oh, what can I get you?
I'll have the special.
Rules of the road. You're one of the
don't
dopes for whom they were made. The rules of the road.
No.
Then suddenly this, the end.
Nice place.
Of the road.
I think I'll do a cannonball.
Don't do a cannonball.
Fairfield Inn, for travelers who know.
I need a key to my room.
Are you done with the sports section?
Consider all the ways you help protect yourself. And if you've had a heart attack, ask your doctor if you're doing enough to help protect your heart. The Heart Protection Study by Oxford University researched Zocor. Zocor, along with diet, is the only cholesterol medication proven to significantly reduce the risk of heart attack and stroke in people with heart disease, regardless of cholesterol level. Zocor is a prescription medicine and is not for everyone, including women who are nursing, pregnant, or may become pregnant, or people with liver problems. Your doctor may do blood tests to check for liver problems. Because serious side effects can result, tell your doctor about any muscle pain or weakness you experience and about any medicines you are taking. If you've had a heart attack, get information about the Heart Protection Study and Zocor and ask your doctor how Zocor can help protect you. It's your future. Be there.
It's a school day imperfect. Here, students arrive in a timely fashion. There are always enough supplies to complete your class project. And even the teachers have a hard time coming in from recess. Of course, life isn't always perfect, so there's Walgreens, open every day, many 24 hours, with everything needed for school. That's life. This is Walgreens.
I'm Kelly Wallace in Washington. A look now at stories making news this hour. The Pentagon has no immediate confirmation, and a senior Pentagon official expressed doubt that a key member of Saddam Hussein's inner circle is in custody. Earlier today, Iraq's defense ministry said Izzat Ibrahim al-Duri, deputy commander of Hussein's armed forces, had been captured near Tikrit. The U.S. military says al-Duri is believed to be behind many of the insurgent attacks in Iraq. Pope John Paul II offered prayers this morning for those killed in a school massacre in Beslan, Russia. That death toll is now at 338. The United States is providing funds and equipment to assist the victims. A plane with specialized medical equipment, including burn beds and monitors, will arrive tomorrow. In campaign 2004, President Bush continues his stomp through key states in the Rust Belt. He'll rally supporters in Parkersburg, West Virginia this afternoon. New polls taken during the first nights of the Republican National Convention show Mr. Bush has opened a double-digit lead over his Democratic opponent, Senator John Kerry. And as for Senator Kerry, he is home with his wife, Teresa, in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania this morning. Teresa Hines Kerry was treated and released at a hospital in Mason City, Iowa yesterday after complaining of an upset stomach. She had been meeting with local Democrats to talk about health care. Keeping you informed, CNN, the most trusted name in news. And as we've been telling you, as many as 200,000 Floridians taking shelter in some 407 shelters throughout the state. We want to turn now to CNN's Jason Bellini, who is covering the storm in Melbourne, Florida, and he joins us from one of those shelters. Jason, what is the situation like there?
Well, Kelly, the shelter I'm in at Brevard Community College in Melbourne, Florida, is still in lockdown. The 850 people here are being told they should absolutely not leave. Well, this morning we've been seeing evidence of frayed nerves. I just heard about two separate incidents at the door of the shelter in which individuals wanted to leave the shelter and got in arguments with police officers. The officers ended up winning the argument. They told the individuals they should not leave, that they cannot guarantee that there's safety, that there are electrical lines on the road. It's just not safe to go out. The halls here are also rumor central. The cable TV has long since went out. People in this facility are listening to different radio stations and reporting what they know to each other in the shelter, and sometimes those reports contradict one another. One thing from personal experience I can tell you is that the coffee shortage here is a real morale crusher. And also, the smokers who want to go outside are being told they cannot. They cannot even step outside because the police are telling them they're taking their life in their hands with the debris projectiles flying through the air. Most people here aren't even thinking about leaving. They know it could be more than 12 hours before it will be safe to leave. They may not be going. We just spoke with a Red Cross official, said they may not be able to go home until Tuesday. Kelly?
Yeah, Jason, I just want to let you know, as you're talking, our viewers are looking at some new video coming in from affiliate WSVN. It looks like a horse might have gotten out of a stable and might be just sort of running through the streets right now. New pictures in from WSVN. Jason, how are people trying to pass the time? Playing cards? What are they doing to try and keep themselves patient before they kind of go stir crazy in these shelters?
Well, believe it or not, people came here with DVD players, with game consoles for their children. There are a lot of elderly people who brought knitting and who brought books to pass the time. You see a lot of people playing cards. But I would say most people spend their day standing around talking to one another, comparing notes, speculating on how their houses are. Kelly?
Well, Jason, we will keep checking in with you. Jason Bellini reporting to us from a shelter in Melbourne, Florida, as people are getting a little bit anxious and wanting to head to their homes, and Florida authorities urging them to stay behind and stay inside until they declare areas are safe. Well, as we've been telling you, with hundreds of thousands of people forced to leave their homes, shelters across Florida are full. Reporter Will Mansell with our affiliate WPLG is at a shelter in North Miami Beach.
The doors are open. People are starting to kind of file their way out of here. And the good thing is they're coming out of here with smiles. It's been a difficult experience over the last few days. There's no doubt that the people that have stayed in these shelters, and this one in particular, have had a tough time. Here are the taxis that you can see. A lot of people, taxis lined up here waiting for people to leave. Families kind of discussing what has gone on the last few days, an experience that certainly they will never, ever forget. There will also be bus service that is coming through here. There's also the you know, the next few minutes or so, as Jackie mentioned, it's 10 a.m. when it starts. So any moment we expect to see buses come over here and see people board those buses and get to go home. That's great news as these people file out. Now, a few moments ago, I had a chance to speak to a couple of people who shared their experiences, how these last few days were. Listen in.
I got three kids, you know, one is one, the other one's four, the other one's eight. So
how did they deal with it?
Hey, you know, they counted on mom and dad. You know, to make them safe.
And did,
you know,
and did they, I mean, are they coming out of this? I guess it's a life lesson learned real at a young age.
Yeah. I just, you know, kept telling them, you know, we're gonna be all right.
Are you looking forward to going back home?
Oh yes, in my bed.
That's gonna be a nice thing.
Right. I just laid on a quilt on the floor.
But for the most part, did you try to make the most of it? I know it's tough to in a time like this.
I had babies next to me, so I helped take care of the babies.
Oh, that motherly instinct, huh?
Yeah, grandmother and great-grandma.
Isn't that a great attitude? After a few days, you know, we've been looking at the damage and all the video and the storms, and these folks were trapped basically inside of here, and even though it was for their safety, they were here, and yet they're leaving with smiles. And here's some of the kids. Wave, go ahead, wave, kids. They've been over here by the camera. They want to say hello because they're going to get to home soon. So finally, some good news. It's been a long few days for people in South Florida, and the Red Cross did such a great job to get everyone safe in these shelters. But at the same time, these folks are ready to go home, and finally, the good news, they are starting to file out of here. As I said, the buses should arrive any moment. Taxis are here. Other people have their own personal cars, friends picking them up. Good news indeed. There you see the bags packed, ready to go where they belong, back home.
So some good news there in North Miami Beach, but a place that is still feeling the brunt of Hurricane Francis, Melbourne, Florida, up along the coast. Our colleague Bill Hemmer is there. We've been talking to him throughout this morning.
Now you can save up to $150 off digital cable and Roadrunner high-speed online. Watch what you want, when you want, and surf the internet at speeds up to 70 times faster than dial-up and up to twice as fast as DSL standard package. Call today to get digital cable and Roadrunner. Save up to $150, plus get free installation, all with one call to one company. Call 612-522-1000 today. Time Warner Cable. Now, anything's possible.
The Twin Cities' most exciting new townhome community is Hartford Commons in Eden Prairie. Whether you're looking for a single-level condo or multi-level townhome, Hartford Commons has the home for you. Neighborhood parks and trails, nearby restaurants, shopping, and easy freeway access make Hartford Commons the best place to live. David Bernard Builders and Developers, Hartford Commons has it all, starting in the 260s. Conveniently located just east of Eden Prairie Center on Prairie Center Drive. Visit Hartford Commons and realize your dream today.
Luggage World has everything today's savvy traveler needs, whether you're traveling around the world or just around town. From the boardroom to the classroom, looking for bargains or looking for adventure, Luggage World carries the largest selection of every major brand for the lowest price. Plus, we're experts in luggage repair and open 7 days a week. Right now, help Luggage World fight cancer by dropping off your old luggage, which Luggage World will repair and donate to the American Cancer Society garage sale. So hurry into Luggage World, where your luggage is our bag, in St. Louis Park.
Be coming around the mountain when she comes. She'll be coming around the mountain when she comes. She'll be coming around the mountain.
Oh, everybody was kung fu fighting.
Hi-ya!
Those cats were fast as lightning.
Wherever you're going, you'll feel really good riding with Geico.
Everybody was kung fu
15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Stay with CNN this weekend for continuous live coverage of Hurricane Francis.
Now the latest summary on Hurricane Francis. The storm remains a Category 1 hurricane, weakening somewhat. Top sustained winds are 90 miles per hour. Serious flooding is still expected, and it is raining over virtually the entire Florida peninsula. Governor Jeb Bush is asking residents and tourists to remain out of harm's way until the storm passes completely. Millions remain without power, mostly in the eastern section of the state where Francis first roared ashore. Forecasters say it could be downgraded to a tropical storm as Francis reaches the Tampa area later today. Many people have already evacuated to Alabama and Georgia. Now authorities are advising remaining residents in Florida to prepare today for the storm's second landfall, expected sometime by Monday morning. Our hurricane warning has been issued from the mouth of the Suwannee River to Destin. So for more on exactly where Hurricane Francis...
On and off throughout the morning, West Palm Beach still keeping in the act, although your weather will be improving slowly but surely as we go through the afternoon. All right, we've already had a tremendous amount of rain with this system in spots. Record rains yesterday in West Palm Beach. And now these are the radar or the rainfall estimates for the state of Florida for the next 24 hours. 14 inches possible in Orlando. Jacksonville, possibly 13.5 inches. Gainesville, Florida, 11.3 inches and 11 inches possible in Tampa Bay. This is starting from about now till Tuesday morning. All right, let's switch sources over to GR-115, and we'll give you an idea of where this thing is and where it's going to go. Direction is moving is westerly at 7 miles an hour. It's a Category 1, strong one, with winds sustained at 90 miles an hour. Now it's 74 miles just to the west of West Palm Beach, or about 80 miles east-southeast of Tampa. It is forecasted to scoot just to the north of Tampa, weakening to a tropical storm, and then eventually strengthening back to hurricane status before it rolls inland sometime during the morning hours on Monday. So that's one of the things that we're concerned about.
CNN, the most trusted name in news.
This is a special late edition. Hurricane Francis hammers Florida.
In the eye of the storm.
Signs were down. Trees were down. Power lines were down. Which gives you an indication, once Francis comes on shore with his hurricane force winds, how strong this storm will be.
Hurricane Francis is pounding much of Florida. We'll get the latest from CNN reporters deployed across the state.
Tropical force winds will create lots of damage. There'll be lots of flooding.
How will the Sunshine State fare after its second battering in 3 weeks? We'll ask state and city leaders of hard-hit areas. And picking up the pieces, we'll talk with recovery experts, including from the American Red Cross. A dramatic convention for President Bush. We'll talk with Bush supporter, former New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani, and get the Democratic response from House Democratic Leader Dick Gephardt.
Live from CNN in Washington, this is Late Edition with Wolf Blitzer.
It's noon in Washington, 9 a.m. in Los Angeles, 5 p.m. in London, 8 p.m. in Moscow. Wherever you're watching from around the world, thanks very much for joining us for this special Late Edition, where we will focus on the marathon hurricane battering Florida right now. The storm is literally moving across almost all of the Sunshine State with drenching rains, 8 to 12 inches in many areas, perhaps as many as 20 inches in some others. There are still pounding 90-mile-an-hour winds. This hurricane is by no means over and could even gather speed as it moves west-northwest and gears up to hit the Florida coastline, the Gulf coastline, and a second landfall along the Florida Panhandle. There's also fear of so-called spin-off tornadoes. Millions of Florida residents are without power. Francis has forced the largest evacuation in the state's history, 2.5 million people. Joining us now from the state's Emergency Operations Center in Tallahassee, Florida's Lieutenant Governor Tony Jennings. Lieutenant Governor Jennings, thanks very much for joining us. First of all, casualties, fatalities, are there significant numbers or any numbers as far as you know right now?
Well, the good news there is we have had absolutely no information or reports of casualties. Hopefully people have heeded the warnings. We had huge evacuations, probably the largest evacuation that the state of Florida has ever had. And our encouragement to others is to stay out. If you're already out of the storm area, stay out. If you're in the storm area, stay inside. So we have had no reported casualties at this point in time.
What is the expectation? How long do you believe the state of Florida, your state, will still be pounded by this hurricane?
Well, it appears, and you said it correctly, this is called the marathon hurricane. It is almost totally encompassing the peninsula part of the state of Florida right now. It will be moving through the state and going out around the Tampa area into the Gulf, and then we'll head back to the Panhandle. So there will be very little of Florida that hasn't been touched by this hurricane, probably by about Tuesday afternoon or a Wednesday, we will be in a clear area. There are parts of the lower southeast right now that the storm is moving out of, but it's going right through Central Florida and coming out into the Gulf and headed back up to the Panhandle.
This is the second hurricane to hit your state in 3 weeks, Hurricane Charley a few weeks ago. Compare these two hurricanes for us, Governor.
Well, interestingly enough, there's very little to compare except the damage areas are going to be crisscrossed. Hurricane Charley came in the southwest, moved out very quickly, came in on Friday afternoon and was out by Saturday morning about 1 o'clock in the morning around Daytona, moved that diagonal across the state. Hurricane Francis, however, has sort of enveloped the entire state of Florida. The ground zero is probably going to be about around Juneau, Indian River County, and that in that particular area, but it came as far south as Broward, as far north as Flagler County, probably hitting the Duval area as we move through. It's going to go right through the center of the state, come out in the Tampa Bay area. And if you had a diagram of it where it crisscrossed right there, is right about Polk County, Osceola County, the Orange County area. So those people have had a double whammy. A lot of damage is going to take place here, a lot of debris, a lot of evacuation, a lot of water, and we're just encouraging people, please, if you still have power and can see this, stay in your homes and stay in there for another day or so, even after the storm passes, because our first responders have to get out and assess the damage.
Tony Jennings, the Lieutenant Governor of Florida, good luck to you, good luck to all the residents
Thank
of
you.
Florida. Thanks very much for joining us. Francis made landfall early this morning, about 70 miles south of the city of Melbourne.
So for the ultimate all-inclusive for two, there's only one name. Sandals, voted world's best for a decade.
What the world needs now is love. Sweet love forever.
Book now for great savings. Call your travel agent or 1-800-SANDALS.
What can the middle of nowhere teach us about financial advisors?
Let's trim it down!
With the right guide, you can find rewards in any environment. Wachovia Securities. Talk to us. Together we can achieve uncommon results.
Once again, more Americans trust CNN than any other news organization. Another reason why CNN is the most trusted name in news.
The history of America is the history of country music, the spirit of America. See over 50 of country's top music stars celebrate America through the contributions made by country music. Country music, the spirit of America, transports audiences through the 20th century on the wings of country music. Don't miss Country Music, the Spirit of America, now playing at the iMation IMAX Theater at the Minnesota Zoo.
Guess what? I can do it. I can hit the beach. I can play volleyball. I can even wear a two-piece. Because thanks to LA Weight Loss, I lost 44 pounds. I can eat that. I can eat that. I can definitely eat that. I can shop for fun. And I can throw that away. I can turn heads. My friends cannot believe it. But I can.
Call for your free consultation, 1-888-371-THIN. 1-888-371-THIN.
An all-new CNN presents Nuclear Terror, Sunday, September 12th, 8 Eastern.
Welcome back to Late Edition and our live coverage of Hurricane Francis in Florida. I'm Wolf Blitzer reporting. One of the cities hard hit by Francis is Melbourne, along the east coast of Florida. Joining us now, the mayor of Melbourne, John Buckley. Mayor, thanks very much for joining us. How's your community doing?
Well, our community took probably the hardest hit that I've seen here, and I've been here for 43 years. It has done a lot of damage, a lot of trees rooted. We've lost most of our signals, the light signals. A lot of them are sitting on the ground as I drove here.
What's the population of Melbourne?
Approximately 74,000.
Did most of the people evacuate in time?
The people on the beach, almost all of those evacuated. And then we have the people that, we have a couple trailer parks. The one at the airport has over 700 units, and they either went to a motel or went to the Melbourne High School for shelter.
Did the wind lift up those trailer homes as we've seen in other hurricanes or tornadoes?
Well, I think they were learned to become honest after what they saw happen in Charlie, that they better clear out because the damage could be very severe.
And so far, our Bill Hemmer, who's there in Melbourne, he said there's no reports, thank God, of fatalities in your city. Is that right?
Not that I've heard of, none at all.
And what about what about injuries?
I haven't heard of any myself. I've talked to police department, but I have not heard of any injuries.
I assume electricity power is completely off in Melbourne. Is that right?
It's off in parts of the city. On the way here, I passed one street light or signal light that was still working, but all the others are down.
When do you believe people will be able to start returning to their homes, or at least what's left of their homes?
The ones that live on the beach will have to wait until the utility companies make a survey and say that it's all right to return. They'll have to wait for that. It may be sometime tomorrow or later.
In other communities, there are already reports of looting, individuals trying to take advantage of this disaster, this natural disaster. Is your local law enforcement getting reports in Melbourne of looting?
I heard this morning that two people, that wasn't in Melbourne, but in the community nearby, two people were picked up trying to loot. 10 people were going into trying to steal clothes, and they caught two of those and recovered $10,000 worth of clothes, and then they found somebody else with burglary tools.
What about the problem of flooding in Melbourne? We understand that the surge could be significant there, and the rain is coming down still pretty hard.
Most of that would occur on the beach side, and I don't think we'll have too much from the river itself. We're fairly high off the river.
So basically what I hear you saying, Mr. Mayor, is that your community anticipated this, was pretty well prepared, and it seems to have handled this hurricane relatively well under the circumstances.
I believe that's the case. I think that the our police department and fire department have really worked hard to make sure that they are ready for a hurricane.
I don't know if anyone is ever ready for a hurricane completely, but under the circumstances, at least Melbourne seems to have done relatively well. Mayor, thanks very much for joining us, John Buckley. Good luck to all the people in Melbourne and the entire community surrounding your city, and indeed to the entire state.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Let's move a little bit northeast now to the city of St. Augustine. That's not far from Jacksonville. CNN's Kathleen Cote is up there. Kathleen, what's the scene there like?
What a difference 3 hours makes. In the 9 o'clock hour, we had maybe 40 mile an hour winds. I think you can safely say they have doubled now. I don't know if behind me you can see the Bridge of Lions. It's a bridge that connects historic old St. Augustine to a barrier island called Anastasia Island. Police about 10:30 this morning shut down the eastbound traffic on that bridge. They haven't shut down westbound. They want to give any residents who are out there the opportunity to evacuate if they haven't yet. But conditions are really deteriorating. Wolf here, I've got to hang on to this railing because these gusts are really intense. Now, it's amazing to me that you see people down on the seawall right now. The police of St. Augustine have been out there the last couple of hours trying to get them in because it just takes one good gust and you could go right over. You can see the waves that are starting to crash over the edge of the seawall. Now, the high tide here, Wolf, isn't due in for about another 2 hours, 1:56 to be precise. This historic old town floods in a bad rainstorm, so they're expecting around 2 p.m. we could have some serious flooding in the downtown area. Now, again,
Kathleen,
as you
I'm
can see...
I'm going to interrupt you. I know you, and I've known you for many years, and you're petite. If you feel that you're in any danger right now and this could get out of control, I want you to stop and go inside and get some shelter, because I'm sure our viewers who are watching you right now are getting a little nervous. And so if it's too much, just stop talking and we'll move on.
We're fine. I have a railing to hang on to here. Actually, we think we're safer here than where we were downtown. In the downtown area, though, earlier this morning, the winds were less intense. We saw very large branches I couldn't even pick up, coming off some of the trees there. So we're actually right here. We are less likely to get hit by something. But Wolf, these are more intense than the winds I felt in Hurricane Isabel. If you watch, I can stand up against the wind. I can lean into it. And I don't fall down. Whoop, now there. It just depends on the gust. But it's very intense. But again, they're encouraging people not to come out in this right now. They want everybody to be seeking shelter. Because you know what we're feeling here, we're on the northeast quadrant. This is one of the most intense quadrants of the storm. We're also under a tornado watch here until the 2 o'clock hour. So you can hear the wind whistling here in a way that it hasn't all day. So they're really wanting everyone to be extraordinarily careful. Earlier this morning, 5 a.m., there was a hurricane warning here in St. Augustine. They had a few touchdowns 10, 15 miles north of here. No severe damage, no loss of life. And as far as we know, the power is still on. But with the winds raging the way they are right now, we expect there probably will be some power outages here soon.
All right, Kathleen Cote, thanks very much. Be careful over there. We remember your earlier experiences with hurricanes as well. Kathleen Cote reporting for us from St. Augustine, a little further north up along the Florida East Coast. Much more coverage of this hurricane still ahead, the latest on Hurricane Frances, including details on what the American Red Cross says will be its largest relief effort ever. Plus, some other stories making news today. Late edition special coverage of Hurricane Frances continues right after this short break.
How is it?
Amazing service. Breathtaking scenery.
Lonely.
You've got your whole company for company.
Oh, honey, I like your company.
Oh, you should have seen the buffet last night.
Nice, huh?
Heartbreaking.
Why heartbreaking?
Because I shared it with Sid Brown from Accounts Receivable.
When will you be home?
Tomorrow.
Can't wait.
Me either.
Oh, Miss Horn, I have you with us for two more nights.
Where you've always wanted to go. Stay.
and never want to leave. It's the Marriott way.
Millions who pay for prescriptions out of their own pockets are already saving with their Medicare-approved drug discount cards. Hope you've got one. Get a card and get saving. Call 1-800-MEDICARE and get started today.
Women. They want to feel their power. They want to flex their muscles. They want to be strong and sweet forever. And they want to enjoy their calcium. One delicious Viactive Soft Calcium Chew twice a day has the same bone-building calcium as those big, chalky pills. Viactive Soft Calcium Chews, because women should get exactly what they want.
What in precision driving teaches about corporate and investment banking? The right combination of horsepower and agility can produce remarkable results. Wachovia Securities, corporate and investment banking. Talk to us.
Trusted. Experienced. Connected. Trust CNN's Paula Zahn. She asks the questions you want answered.
What do you say to critics of the Bush administration?
Paula Zahn now. CNN Monday, 8 p.m. Eastern.
CNN Tuesday night, Ellen DeGeneres, the groundbreaking comedy superstar, opens up for a no-holds-barred hour on her life, her career, and whatever you want. Ellen DeGeneres takes your calls, only on Larry King Live, CNN Tuesday night, 9 Eastern.
Hello, I'm Frederica Whitfield at the CNN Center in Atlanta. Here are the stories now in the news. Part of northwest Florida is under a hurricane warning as Frances lumbers in that direction. The storm still has sustained winds of 90 miles per hour and has left nearly 2 million households in central and eastern Florida without electricity. Stay with CNN for Frances updates and the latest on relief effort. A live interview with Dr. Bernadine Healy, former president of the American Red Cross, coming up right here on CNN. Iraq's defense ministry has announced the capture of the deputy commander of Saddam Hussein's armed forces, Izzat Ibrahim al-Duri. The ministry says he was captured near Tikrit by Iraqi National Guard forces and American troops, but the U.S. military has not confirmed the capture. And a senior Pentagon official is expressing some doubt about that report. A U.S. soldier and two Iraqis were wounded in a car bomb explosion 30 miles north of Baghdad. The U.S. military says it captured three suspects for questioning. The bomb went off just as a U.S. patrol was passing by. Russians filled with anger and grief began burying the victims of a school siege today. Children, teachers, and others were among the at least 350 people killed in a bloody end to a hostage crisis at the school near the Chechen border. I'm Frederica Whitfield. More of Late Edition right after this.
Fidelity Active Trader Services. Power, price, service, no compromises. Call 1-800-TRADER-1 to open an account today.
Could I just borrow your network for a sec? I need to look at your data. I hear there's data in there. Lower your mortgage, meet girls, grow hair.
Detect and eliminate virtually any security threat. Can your network do this? It can, with the world's networking company, AT&T.
Introducing the ultimate buttery spread, new Smart Balance Omega Plus, with natural plant sterols and omega-3 from the sea. To help promote healthy cholesterol and triglyceride levels, Omega Plus contains no hydrogenated oil and no trans fatty acids, with a right balance of fats for smart eating, plus a delicious buttery taste. Try the Ultimate Buttery Spread. New Smart Balance Omega Plus.
Our new fire-grilled chicken and shrimp. Consider this your invitation. Welcome to Romano's Macaroni Grill.
Well, folks are pretty curious about bugs, so they talk to me.
Ned, can a cockroach really live a week with its head cut off?
Ew, he said yes.
People see this uniform and they see an expert. Yeah, and that's me. I'm the Orkin man. I'm just a phone call away.
Here is to yes, to can do. Every day you aim higher, dig deeper, push harder, you demand more. And Deutsche Bank, as a leading financial institution, shares your passion. Thinking bigger, pressing further. That's why the world's most demanding clients trust Deutsche Bank to perform. Deutsche Bank, a passion to perform.
Here's the deal. Every day there are people out there making decisions that affect you. Who holds them accountable? Who cuts through the spin? CNN's Lou Dobbs. After all, these days, who can you trust? Lou Dobbs. CNN Monday, 6 p.m. Eastern.
Welcome back to Late Edition special coverage of Hurricane Frances in Florida. The 1-2 punch of Frances and Hurricane Charley in the span of only 3 weeks poses an even bigger challenge for relief efforts. Joining us now with some perspective on what's involved, the former president of the American Red Cross, Dr. Bernadine Healy. Dr. Healy, welcome back to Late Edition. Give us some perspective. How big of a problem is this in terms of the humanitarian crisis unfolding?
Well, I think what's special about Frances is that it is over such a wide geographic area. You have so many people displaced from their homes, over 100,000, perhaps 200,000 in various shelters by the American Red Cross, the Salvation Army. This is a humanitarian crisis. People are deprived of their home. They're deprived of their livelihood for a period of time. But, Wolf, the big issue here is not just the hurricane, it's the winds, but it's also the water that could come in and provide a much, much more lasting problem for those people, for those victims, and also for the rescue efforts.
4 million people, we're told right now, without power. That in and of itself represents potentially an enormous challenge for relief workers. Explain some of the significance of that.
Well, I mean, you can't obviously function in a modern society without having electricity, without having something we take for granted. It affects hospitals, it affects rescue efforts, and it's an enormous burden on the utilities to get that up and get it up quickly. You also can't have people return to their homes if they don't have access to energy. And there are also risks if you get back into a flooded home in terms of potential live wires that could be causing water problems if you walk into a basement and there's a live wire. So there are a lot of risks. I think that with FEMA, I think with the volunteer societies, I think we really do have a chance to.
Nightmare that these folks have been worried about.
Let's go.
This is amazing. This is the worst so far. I can't turn my head right now. I don't know how Scott is doing it. It feels like rocks pelting your body. That's what it feels like right now.
Here's what we've, you know, found in the street, and this is why you're not supposed to come out. We're not sure what this piece of metal is, but it's definitely dangerous. And this is another reason why they ask you, do not come outside of your house. This is why you evacuate.
This is going to be large scale. Every shingle on the roof gonna be gone. You may not lose the sheeting under the roof, but you're gonna start losing, and we're already seeing it now, you're gonna start losing siding just because it keeps going and going.
The conditions, I would say, are not good right now. As we've been saying, the sustained winds right now are 90 miles per hour. And if you remember, I wondered if a 170-pound man could withstand 90-mile-per-hour winds. The answer is yes, but barely.
This is powerful, and let me tell you, this rain feels like somebody nailing you with pins, needles, and rice all at the same time.
As you can hear and see, this wind is ferocious. I'm going to have photojournalist Jeff Sweeney panel with just a bit so that you can see where many of us slept. Right here, one of our windows, and the wind was just rushing up against here, howling, and that's what you had to fall asleep to. Very nerve-wracking, but of course for us, everything was safe here, but there are a lot of people waking up in shelters who don't know what they're going to go home to. They don't know what's going to be left behind.
And our thanks to all our CNN reporters and our affiliate reporters, as well as their crews, their producers, for outstanding coverage.